ilgilendiğim bir sürü şey, iki alanlarını bir arada toplayabileceğim bir meslek buldum. Evet. Bunun için çok şanslıyım. Ve işimi severek yapıyorum.
Diego'nun yemeklik stratejisi ve ilham kaynağı nedir? İçinde ahtapot olmayan ahtapot filanı ya da balık olmayan hamsiyi yapma sebebi nedir?
Okay, if you look at my way of cooking, I think that I hope that you will find that the main character, the main point of my way of cooking is that it wants to be free. The less rules I have, more creative I can be. So, and if I have to be honest with myself and be true, if I tell you that I became a chef to tell stories, the stories is what happens here through life. So if I travel, for example, to Turkey, I'm going to try here to learn as much as possible, to know about your food, your culture, your way of living, and for sure that it goes in my heart and my head, so I'm going to come back to my home, and for sure that in some way, maybe just in a dish, it's going to be a little influence of this experience, because this is life. I mean, if I have to express, I have to tell the people in the restaurant that I've been in Turkey some way. So, the sources of inspiration are many, many, plenty of, because you have your journey, your travel. You can find it through a product. You can find it in a talk with another guys. You can go to your roots, to your memories, and then you can find the dish or the flavor that when you were a child in your country and try to rescue these flavors and put in a dish in 2017. There are many, many, many sources of inspiration, and the more sources you have, you can be more creative, you can be more real at the end. And I try to have no rules. I don't want to. I am 42. I don't want to be the number one of anything. I don't want to be in any box. You are doing this kind of type of kitchen or this other type of kitchen. I want you to come to the stage, to the restaurant, enjoy the experience and to feel that the people, the team that is working there, is working with the heart to make you happy for the time that you are there. So that's it. The lady. I remember. Ah, okay, sorry. I think that you understand.
Şefimiz diyor ki, ilham aslında her yerde, her yerden toplamaya çalışıyorum. Mesela Türkiye'ye geldim ve etrafı gördüm, restoranları gezdim ve buradan bir şeyler kaptım. İlhamı buradan da aldım ve restorana geri döndüğümde bu ilhamın bir parçası da benimle gelecek. Ve yemeklerim de bu şekilde etkilenecek Türkiye'de aldığı ilhamla. Ve ilhamını her yerden alabilirsin. Gittiğin, ziyaret ettiğin ülkeler olabilir. Hatta çocukluğuna indiğinde, çocukluğunda bulduğun parçalar, gastronomik kültür parçaları. Ve sonunda bunu severek yemeğime uyguluyorum. Ve aynı zamanda dedi ki, 42 yaşındayım ve hani artık bir numara ya da bir şey olmakta gözüm yok. Sadece iyi yemek, severek yemek yapmak istiyorum. Ve ilhamı da her yerden gezerek, görerek bulabilirim.
Really, I never thought that I would like to be a chef. When I was 18 and I have to choose between in Spain, when you do like the previous to the university, it's like a one year, and you have to decide like three different possibilities of career that you wanted to do. And I didn't know what I wanted. So I was between journalists, to write, painter, to paint, And the chef was the last choice, like, oh, I have to choose another one, let's see what happens, last chef. Because if you see all of them in the side of an 18 guy, boy, was like a job or profession where someone can express himself, you know, writing, painting, you know, cooking, doing things with your hands. My parents told me, okay, whatever you want, but not cook. Yeah, why not? Because we never see you taking any knife and doing it on a fried egg. You're never doing anything. And I was 18, you know, you were a rebel. And your parents say no, you say yes. And you go, I want to cook. And your parents say no, and I want to cook. And then I became a chef. That's it. I'm still trying to convince them that I wasn't the reason. I had the reason.
18 yaşında 3 tane seçeneğim oldu. Okulda bir seçeneğim vardı. Biri sanat, gazetecilik, jurnalizm, gazetecilik, bir de aşçılık vardı. Ailem dedi ki yani istediğini seçebilirsin, sadece aşçılık olmasın dedi. O yüzden çünkü yani hiç eline ne tava aldığını gördük, ne bıçak aldığını gördük dediler. 18 yaşında bir genç olarak biraz asiliğim tuttu ve yani ailem hayır deyince benim evet diyesim geldi. Dolayısıyla bu şekilde şef oldum.
One, two, three, four, five, whatever, your turn. There are five. Yeah, go fast. Five, six. I'm okay, whatever you want. I can answer six, ten, whatever.
Çok başarılı bir şef kendisi dünyada. Kendisinin de İspanya'da veya dünyada örnek aldığı veya çalışmalarını beğendiği bir şef var mı takip ettiğiniz?
So you're a very famous chef, world-renowned chef.
Do you think?
Well, everyone's here, so. Who do you look up, who do you like, who do you look upon? Which chefs, maybe in Barcelona or in Spain or like in the world, chefs,
oh,
who do you like?
Yeah, which, who are my references, for example, something like that. Okay. I'm lucky because I have the opportunity to know my idols and to be close to them. If you want to translate this and then I continue, no question.
Çok şanslı oldum çünkü idollerimle tanışma fırsatım oldu.
So, I love the people and not only chefs. I love the people who inspire me. I think that they are the real people that we have to look to, the people who are able to inspire to the others, or to maybe the ones they try to inspire the others, no? So if we talk about chefs, for example, Antoni from Bugaris for me is a big inspiration, as a good friend, Ferran, for example. I'm not saying anything that anyone knows, everybody knows. So these are real genius and these are people who have changed the rules of the things. This maybe this the most inspiring thing that you can find in your job, because they give you the freedom to do your own work. You don't want to copy the work. You have to get inspired and feel free to tell the story in your own way.
Öncelikle sadece şefleri değil, bir sürü idolüm olan bir sürü insanla tanışma fırsatım oldu. Ve bu insanlar ben de başkalarına, herkese ilham veren insanlardı. Mesela örneğin Ferran Adria. Bu tarz insanlar sadece işini kopyaladığım değil, bana ilham verecek ve yeni bir şeyler yaratmana yol açacak insanlardı.
Çok
iyi. Both in your presentation.
I was listening to you because I was thinking that you were speaking in Turkish, so I was waiting for the translation. Can you repeat again?
In the Turkish thing.
No, whatever you want.
So in your presentation and during this chat, you have emphasized the importance of inspiration many times. I was wondering, what is your main element of inspiration regarding Turkish cuisine when creating your own food or menu or any dish? Like, you know, when you go back to your home, what will be your main idea of Turkish cuisine, and, you know, creating something that you want to put something from the Turkish culinary?
For the Turkish culinary,
yes.
Yeah.
Dediğiniz gibi ilhamınız sizin en önde tuttuğunuz konu. Peki Türkiye'ye geldiğinizden sonra evinize götüreceğiniz, İspanya'ya götüreceğiniz bir numaralı en sağlam ilham kaynağınız nedir?
Okay, it's not as fast as maybe you can think. You have to feel the things previously, you know? We here have seen a lot of things. Now we have to go back home and we have to, you know, take our notes, try to find products and ask a lot of questions. And then with all this information, we have to go back home, process it, and let's see what happened when you go back. What are your feelings? Because now, here, you are all the time receiving different inputs. So maybe it's not the right time to process this and to say, oh, I want to do this thing when I come home. For example, if I go to a baklava workshop, I'm trying to pay a lot of attention, see with the process, understand the process, see which kind of flour do they use, which kind of sugar, whatever, you know. And then I have to go back home and then remember, what do they do with this? Can you try to do, not a baklava, how can I tell a Turkish experience, but in another way, you know. But in a way that when a Turkish guy looked at, remembered his country, and when another one that's who is not Turkish and doesn't know and never been to Turkey, we can show a little bit of the another country's culture. For example, if I go, I'm not going to do a baklava. For example, I'm going to do like the durum, for example. I like the shape of the durum. Why don't we do like a salty durum, but inside it has all the flavors of turkey, like you know, the metzes or maybe the lamb, or not pistachio, for example, because this is this would be copying a recipe. I don't want to copy in a recipe. I want to do an interpretation of the things that I have seen. But it's something like an honor to a country. But this is the way I think, maybe. It may be a little bit crazy for you to spend now so quickly, because maybe you are Turkish and you are mind now a turon with lamb, what the fuck is this? No. But it works, believe me.
Sure.
Thank you.
So,
there's one another one behind you was first. Sorry.
Türkiye'ye geldim ve hani bir sürü bombardımanı oldu, yani bir sürü şey gördüm. Dolayısıyla şu an biz yapıp bunların hepsini sindirmek olamaz. Şu an sadece gözlem yapıyorum, bakıyorum ve neler olduğunu görüyorum. Ve evime gittiğimde asıl o zaman onları analiz edip, asıl o zaman düşünüp, üzerinde bir şeyler tartışıp ortaya bir şey çıkartacağız. Mesela burada örneğin baklava dükkanına gittiğimde, mesela unu nedir, şekeri nedir, onlara bakıyor detaylı bir şekilde. Ondan sonra gittiğimde bunu farklı bir şekilde yapmayı düşünüyorum. Mesela dürümü çok beğendim. Mesela baklava değil de dürümün şeklini çok beğendim. Ama bunu mesela Türk tatlarıyla nasıl yapabilirim? İçine kuzu koyulabilir, bir şey koyulabilir. Yani Anadolu lezzetini verecek bir şey. Yani baklava değil. Çünkü baklava yapılmış ve yani iyisi burada var. Ama ondan esinlenerek çıkabilecek başka bir şey, essiz bir şey yapmayı düşünüyorum.
Gençken Elbuli'de bulunmuş bir varsayım üzerinden bir soru. Diyelim ki Ferran Adrià, Diego daha çok gençsin, yeniden başlıyoruz. Her şeyi bir kenara bırakıp bana katılır mısın, seni görmek istiyorum dese, tutumun ne olur?
So you were in Elbuli in a very young age?
No, I never been in Elbuli.
Okay. Question is, your idol Ferran, if he were, this is just an assumption, if he were just to ask you to leave everything and come work for me and we can work together, would be your answer?
Well, depending in at what age and in what time of my life, he will ask me. You know, if I was young, if he asked me right now, I should say, no, it's an honor, but I can't. I have a lot of responsibilities, but we can work together in some way, yeah. At least, that's what I told you, that we were lucky, because I have the opportunity to be close to my references, to my icons, so I have the opportunity to talk with them or to ask for advice. So some ways, it's a way of working together, yeah, because you are able to make a lot of questions to them. When Ferran was, for example, at this stage, it was a big opportunity for us, because you have the opportunity to ask many questions about your work, your job, your business, or what do you think about this, what do you think about that. When they came, we are very lucky, because a lot of chefs has passed through the stage to see our job. So we feel very lucky and we're very honored to have all these idols for us and references for us.
Evet, hayır mı şimdi?
Evet, öncelikle
ülkemize... Orta, pardon affedersin. Yani orta şekerli bir şey. Şu an tabii ki bir sürü sorunum var. Teklif mi geliyor kısa?
Şeflerimiz. Şimdi ilk olarak İspanya'nın güneydoğu kıyısındaki deniz ürünlerini kullanımıyla ünlü Michelin yıldızlı şefimiz Kiko Moya geliyor.
Okay. Thank you, Goldman, for this opportunity to know this beautiful country, to taste your flavors. I want to show you my landscape in Cocentaina, Alicante. Let's go with a short video. Thank you. Cuando Goldman me dio la oportunidad de poder venir aquí al Congreso y hablar un poco de nuestro paisaje, de nuestros productos, vimos y me sugirió la idea de que podía hablar sobre la almendra. Tenemos muchos platos con almendra. Os voy a presentar tan solo un par de recetas que hacemos en casa. Nosotros estamos en Cocentaina, Alicante. Este vídeo es de una experiencia que hicimos en Madrid hace unos cuantos años, por eso la situación. Y cuando de alguna forma nos mudemos durante un mes, estuvimos en un restaurante pop-up, una experiencia muy interesante. Y cuando nos mudemos de Alicante a Madrid, en esta experiencia pop-up, es cuando te obligas a hacer las maletas. Es como si cualquiera de ustedes de repente un día tienen que hacer las maletas e irse a vivir a otra ciudad, y te obligas a ordenar todo lo que tienes en casa, a ordenar y a llevarte realmente lo más importante, lo que más importa. Os puedo decir que prácticamente hasta esa fecha tal vez no habíamos reflexionado cuánto alicantinos éramos, ¿no? Cuánto de nuestra zona de Cocentaina éramos. Y el esfuerzo fue el intentar de alguna forma trasladar esos sabores, esa mediterraneidad a un concepto en el centro de la capital, ¿no? Y eso fue tal vez lo que en parte nos hizo reflexionar en torno a nuestro trabajo, a lo importante que era nuestro paisaje. Creo que al final Por supuesto está la interacción que tiene el cocinero con el paisaje, con su entorno, pero es tremendamente importante ver de qué forma se puede interpretar. Al final vemos lo importante que es nuestra cocina asociada a nuestro paisaje y cómo el viaje a La Escaleta, nuestro restaurante, se inicia desde cualquier ciudad, desde Alicante, desde Valencia, hasta nuestra casa. Todo esto que el cliente ve durante su viaje es para nosotros importante que esté reflejado en la comida, en el plato, en la mesa. Y intentamos siempre que esto sea así, que no sea ajeno. Vamos a intentar explicar un poco lo que hacemos en nuestra casa mediante dos platos que hablan muy mucho de esto, ¿no? Tenemos un queso fresco de leche de almendra. Voy a poner el tiempo. Tenemos un queso fresco de leche de almendra en el que elaboramos a partir de almendra fresca, almendra sin tostar. Que simplemente lo que hacemos es triturar la almendra con leche o agua. En este caso es leche, porque la leche da un poquito más de untuosidad, de cremosidad al plato. Y lo que hacemos es triturar la almendra, dejarlo reposar en frío con la leche y luego simplemente licuamos. Licuamos hasta obtener esta leche cremosa. Yo siempre he pensado que estamos en un momento excepcional en el que de alguna forma podemos aunar conceptos muy antiguos con técnicas muy modernas. Creo que es un momento fantástico de la gastronomía donde tal vez lo más difícil sea encontrar el criterio para saber qué receta tienes que utilizar. No es tanto el problema de la receta, es más el problema de qué forma esto lo podemos plasmar. ¿Cuáles son nuestras herramientas para poderlo hacer? Bueno, pues nos dimos cuenta que en muchos casos la leche de almendra se utilizaba para espesar diferentes elaboraciones, salsas, etc. Porque la almendra tiene almidón de forma natural y esto permitía que de alguna forma diera cuerpo a cualquier elaboración. En este caso lo que hacemos es hervir esta leche de almendra. Con cuidado para que no se agarre precisamente por el almidón que se nos va a agarrar en la base de la sartén. En la zona, no es una zona de quesos, es una zona de queso tierno. Y la idea era cómo utilizar la almendra de una forma descontextualizada, lo que se solía hacer. Pensemos en hacer un queso fresco en el que el sabor de almendra fuera lo más importante, ¿no? Por lo tanto, hervimos la leche hasta que el almidón esté cuajado, un poquito más. Es una lástima porque no se ve la elaboración, aunque me habían dicho que sí que se iba a ver. Algo que hacemos siempre en las recetas con leche de almendra es introducir almendra amarga en la elaboración. Tenemos localizado una serie de árboles de almendra amarga y ponemos 5 almendras amargas por cada kilo de almendra tierna. Bueno. Lo que haría sería hervir. ¿Vale? Como veis, ya adquiere una textura cremosa en el que simplemente lo que vamos a hacer es ponerle un poquito de cuajo como si fuéramos a hacer un queso fresco, una cuajada. Ponemos unas gotas de cuajo. y una gelatina, unas colas de gelatina normal que habremos hidratado previamente. La gelatina es importante porque el queso se nos queda cremoso, pero no lo suficiente como para que nos cuaje. Es una receta esta que elaboremos hace ya unos cuantos años, unos 7-8 años. Le tengo especial cariño porque de alguna forma marcó una tendencia en la forma de pensar en nuestra casa, en la Escaleta, que para mí, como os decía, dio inicio a una serie de platos que hablaban mucho de nuestro entorno y que hablan muy especialmente de lo que queremos hacer en la Escaleta. Bueno, hemos mezclado bien los ingredientes. Simplemente lo que vamos a hacer es como una especie de queso fresco, aunque la primera idea era hacerlo con servilleta, que es los quesos que allí se utilizan. Simplemente lo que vamos a hacer es darle forma. Como una especie de, para que entendáis, una especie de mozzarella, algo así parecido. Bueno, esta sería un poquito la idea. Esto, por supuesto, lo pondríamos a enfriar. Obtendríamos, por lo tanto, estas piezas de queso. Como os decía, uno de los ingredientes importantes en nuestra casa o en nuestro entorno es la almendra, la miel y el aceite de oliva virgen. Por lo tanto, en este plato, para mí es muy importante y habla mucho de nuestra región, porque utilizamos estos tres ingredientes para este plato. Es un aperitivo, como os decía, también podría ser un postre, pero nosotros lo decidimos optar por hacer un aperitivo. Tenemos, por lo tanto, aquí una hidromiel, es decir, agua, miel rebajada, para que no tenga ese sabor excesivamente dulce. Le ponemos un poquito de santana para que coja cuerpo y la idea es que parezca una miel. Un poquito de aceite de oliva. Bueno, creo que en muchas zonas, especialmente en el norte de Marruecos, por ejemplo, es una bienvenida la miel y el aceite de oliva. En este caso, es un aperitivo también de bienvenida. La miel dulce combinada con el aceite amargo, ligeramente amargo, nos da unos sabores muy interesantes. El queso. Y finalmente, unas almendras que hemos hidratado simplemente poniéndolas en agua con un poquito, con algunas almendras amargas que acompañamos en el plato y un poquito de hinojo de nuestra casa. Bueno, esta sería mi primera propuesta pensada en el territorio, en la almendra, especialmente. Gracias. Bueno, vamos con la siguiente propuesta. Bueno, creo que al final, como os decía, son platos que están pensados especialmente en el territorio, en cosas o que a nosotros nos son evocadoras, incluso que hacen referencia a poetas y a poesía que tenemos en la región. En este caso, Hay un poeta muy importante en Alicante que se llama Miguel Hernández, en el que nos habla de los campos espumosos o campos de espuma de leche de almendra. Con esa reflexión es con la que nosotros arrancamos este plato. Para nosotros es un paisaje cambiante, el almendro, que hay, por supuesto, aquí en Turquía, que sabéis que cuando florece es un espectáculo, cuando cae la flor también lo es, porque los campos se cubren de blanco. Y nosotros hacemos un seguimiento a todo el proceso de maduración, desde la flor hasta el fruto. En este proceso se fija especialmente este plato que os voy a presentar. Tenemos una leche infusionada, no lo podéis ver, o casi sí, ahora sí, bien. Tenemos una leche que hemos infusionado en flores de almendro. La flor de almendro allí en Cocentaina florece sobre febrero. Es curioso porque este año pasado el clima es muy extremo y en febrero podemos tener días de mucho calor, pero podemos tener fuertes heladas por la noche. Y siempre la almendra está en ese equilibrio entre que un año puede salir y otro año puede simplemente quemarse por el frío. Esto fue bonito y triste al mismo tiempo, porque el día anterior que recolectemos las flores, justo esa noche cayó una fuerte helada y quemó todas las flores que habían en nuestro entorno. Claro, el campo es duro y es duro precisamente por esto, ¿no? Nosotros conseguimos captar ese momento, ¿no? esa sensación, ese producto que al final desapareció. Lo que vamos a hacer es, vamos a montar, es una leche, como os decía, infusionada con la flor del almendro. Vamos a ir montándola. Le he quitado ya, bueno, se ve aquí, le he quitado ya las flores, las he quitado y las he colado y están ya montando. Bueno, para mí es algo interesante, ¿no? Cómo podemos captar ese proceso, ¿no? Ese proceso de maduración desde la flor hasta el almendro. Efectivamente, ahora no tenemos almendra, flor de almendro, pero creo que, por ejemplo, los encurtidos, yo siempre pienso que los encurtidos son como fotografías en tres dimensiones. De alguna forma, captan la textura, el aroma, el sabor, y lo podemos no tener una fotografía en Instagram, sino las podemos tener en tarros, en bolsas de vacío. Y también habla mucho de nuestra cultura. Pero es cierto que se encurtía otras cosas. Flores de almendro o la almendra cuando está tierna, no. En este caso, tenemos como tres productos muy diferentes, o varios productos diferentes dentro de esto, ¿no? Tenemos por un lado la flor de la almendra que hemos encurtido, como os comentaba antes. Es el momento exacto de coger la flor, que dura apenas una semana. Y vamos haciendo el seguimiento de lo que es la almendra verde, la almendra tierna. Son productos diferentes, así como la almendra cuando empieza a cuajar o la almendra cuando está acabada de cuajar. Son todos productos fascinantes que en este caso hablan del paisaje, ¿no? De los almendros. Bueno, como os decía, estamos montando esta espuma de leche, de almendra. Lo ideal sería congelarlo. Creedme que lo he intentado, pero es complicado cuando viajas fuera poder tener todo como te gustaría. De hecho, el helado, que no lo es un helado de leche de almendra. Vamos a imaginar que es un helado de leche de almendra. Iría en la base, simplemente infusionando en la misma técnica que hemos utilizado antes, sin llegar a cuajar, por supuesto. Hacemos un helado con una base de leche de almendra, ¿no? Una crema blanca con leche de almendra. Como os decía, en este caso, vamos a imaginar que estoy poniendo una quenelle de helado, fantástica. Bueno, esto os puedo prometer que es simplemente leche y flor de almendra. No tiene ningún tipo de espesante, ninguno emulsionante. Como os decía, me parece fantástico. No tengo nada en contra y utilizo, de hecho, espesantes y tal, pero siempre si podemos ir a la vía más, no sé si llamarle natural, o pues si podemos ir a la vía más... para mí la mejor vía es la más sencilla, ¿no? Contra más sencillo del plato, para mí mejor es, porque mejor transmite lo que quieres hacer. Intentamos siempre que nuestros platos sean muy, muy sencillos. Una propuesta que pueden ser 20 platos, al final, saturar con excesiva información me parece excesivo, ¿no? Entonces, menos, en mi caso, pienso que siempre es más, ¿eh? Bueno, ¿veis? Aquí tenemos la... Simplemente hemos montado esa espuma de leche, como os decía, evocando a ese... a ese poema de Miguel Hernández, en el que habla de campos nevados de espuma de leche. Aquí lo que haríamos, lo que hacemos, para darle textura, es congelarlo. En un batidor frío, lo que hacemos es congelarlo. Contiene una textura como una especie de nieve. Si seguramente habéis, alguno de vosotros, mi madre, recuerdo que nos contaba... porque ahora mismo todos tenemos helados en casa, pero me acuerdo que no hace mucho, al menos en España, quien quería comer un helado, cuando nevaba, salían los niños, cogían la nieve, le ponían un poquito de azúcar y se la comían, ¿no? Era un divertimento, pero era algo maravilloso, ¿no? Esa, reproducir la textura de la nieve, para mí ha sido como una obsesión y de alguna forma... En esta técnica se puede prácticamente tocar, ¿no? ese punto de nieve. Bueno, al final lo que vamos a hacer es introducir en este poste de almendra diferentes almendras o diferentes formas, texturas que tiene la almendra. En este caso es una almendra, como os decía, que hemos encurtido. Una parte de miel, una parte de vinagre y una parte de agua. Como os decía también, no tenemos la flor, pero sí que tenemos la flor encurtida. La encurtimos en esa misma base, con ese aroma tan fantástico que tiene la miel, la flor, perdón, que a mí me recuerda mucho, por supuesto, a miel. En este caso, encurtido con miel de almendro. Y por último... Y por último, esta almendra tierna que habla muy mucho de esa textura y de este, para mí, como os decía, un pequeño universo que significa cada producto en el momento que empiezas a explorarlo. Esta sería nuestra segunda propuesta. Gracias. Me gustaría, antes de despedirme, me gustaría que vierais un pequeño vídeo que habla mucho de nuestra casa, de nuestra familia, de un evento que para nosotros fue algo muy importante hace el año pasado, justo en casa del señor Joan Roca, donde nos otorgaron nuestra segunda estrella Michelin, que como os decía, para nosotros fue un sueño cumplido, y me gustaría que compartirlo con vosotros. Gracias.
Antes de nada te pregunto, ¿qué tenéis de setas?
Bueno, tú en cuanto tengas algo, me lo mandas. Mandas el WhatsApp que ya lo tienes y me dices, ¿te he mandado esto? ¿Vale? No te falta que te llame yo, ¿vale? Vale. De acuerdo, Manolo, así quedamos. Vale, muchas gracias, hasta luego.
nosotros hemos convivido de forma natural con todo el proceso de la hostelería, las fiestas, las comidas, los productos, los vinos, ¿no? Y el proceso poco a poco va cambiando, y al final inicio estudios y después los dejo un poco porque al final uno es consciente de que realmente lo que le llama la atención no es lo que pensaba o lo que tenía idealizado, sino cosas que tenía más próximo, centrarme en el curso sommelier, que fue lo que destapó un poco el melón, ¿no? Yo creo que todos soñamos con ese formato un poco de restaurantes de grandes casas con gerencia familiar, ¿vale? Yo creo que al final nos gusta hacer las cosas bien, que es un poco una cosa que hemos aprendido desde pequeños, hacerlo lo mejor posible que podamos en todos los aspectos e intentar aportar esa pequeña dosis de felicidad, más que esa sensación de tengo que aportar una experiencia vital, sino que la gente disfrute en nuestra casa.
Bueno, el temps es realmente importante en la escalera. Una de las cosas que me agradaría hacer, y que no va a hacer, y espero hacer algún día, es sumar el temps que les nostres elaboracions aporten a un menú. Pensar que, d'alguna forma, el teu comensal, el teu client, està regalant-li temps. Jo, per a fer este menú, a banda de fer-te-lo, executar-te-lo, però he tingut elaboracions que han estat un mes, sis mesos, un any, secant-se, macerant-se, i en una ciutat això no passa. No tens eixe sol, no tens eixe temps, no tens eixe llum, i jo crec que l'escaleta no seria el mateix en un altre lloc que no tinguem tot això. Tots aquests recursos formen part, com forma part la sal, l'oli d'oliva, les ametlles, o sigui, el temps, la llum, el sol, tot això forma part de l'escaleta.
Sí, no, claro, nunca ya.
Es una foto que es curiosa, ¿eh? Es curiosa porque dices, ¿qué tiempo
es? Es que hemos sido jóvenes también.
34
sí,
años.
Hemos sido jóvenes.
Hace 34 años. Sí,
sí. La escaleta ya habíamos puesto ya hasta el letrero de neón.
A cabo de unos años, ahí los fue cuando, de carretera
ahí
tuvieron.
Fue cuando Enrique el Tartaja
sí.
Confundía neón, estaba en el rótulo y decía, ahí lo mejor que sería un rótulo, pero así, que se viera de arriba abajo de neón.
Sí.
Y el Tartaja estaba escuchando y no sabía lo que era nada, no sabía lo que era el
neón. Lo que era neón.
Y él asentaba así con la cabeza. Y empezaron a decir, entonces el neón, ¿qué iría mejor? Verde, amarillo, y ya se hartó ya, no entraba en la conversación y dice, el neón, ¿cómo va a ser verde? El neón, tiene que ser groguet. Un león, pero y nosotros, ¿pero de qué león estás hablando? No dice que vais a poner encima el letrero un león. Un neón.
Se creía que era un león.
Sí, ¿no te acuerdas tú?
¿Cómo tiene que ser un león verde?
sé que tendrás que llorar. Dirás que no me quisiste, pero vas a estar muy triste. Y así te vas a quedar. Con dinero y sin dinero, y hago siempre lo que quiero, y mi palabra es la ley. No tengo trono ni reina, ni nadie que me comprenda, pero sigo siendo el rey.
Bueno, gracias. Good luck.
Evet, şefimize çok teşekkür ediyoruz bu keyifli video için de ayrıca. Şimdi bu şefimiz de bize çok güzel bir sunum hazırladı mutfağımızda. Kendisi The World's 50 Best Restaurant listesinde 28. Asia's 50 Best Restaurant listesinde ise 5. sırada yer alan Bangkok'taki nam restoranın şefi David Thompson.
They're not quite yet.
Teknik aksaklığımız oldu. Bir önceki sunumda da görüntü ekrana gelmemişti. Şimdi o aksaklık da giderildi. Şefimiz için tezgah yeniden hazırlanıyor. Çok az vaktinizi rica ediyoruz.
Ladies and gentlemen. I think I'll start. We're not quite ready, but that's okay. Thai food is one of the most remarkable foods in the world. No, actually, let me begin by saying, why am I cooking Thai food? Because it seems so unlikely that somebody like me is cooking Thai food. He's a much more likely man to cook Thai food. I first went to Thailand almost 30 years ago. And I fell in love with the place. I fell in love with the people, the culture, the cuisine, every aspect of Thailand, really. And I was drawn to it because it was crazy. Almost irrational, certainly incomprehensible. And I was transfixed by it. I still am, I must confess. It was only about, it wasn't first of all about the food, but slowly, inevitably, unavoidably, I became drawn in. I became drawn in because Thai food is one of the best cuisines in the world. Certainly, it's one of the best types of cooking. It's a complicated cuisine. It's quite at odds with much Western food, where its simplicity and one or two ingredients may be employed. Thai food is ornate. Thai food is elaborate. Thai food's a bitch to cook too, I hasten to say. But Thai food is remarkable because of the array of tastes and flavors. And that's for one main reason. It's the products employed. Thailand has some of the most remarkable products in the world. And I know every country says that, but at least when cooking Thai food, it's extraordinary. It's an ancient cuisine as well, going back generations upon generations. But the basis of Thai food is rice. And what were we playing today? Oh, by the way, this is Prin, who is my boss at NAM. He's the head chef. I'm just merely a chap that sort of flutters in and flutters out somewhat. But the basis of Thai cooking is rice. It is the most important thing. It is the staple. It is the basis upon which everything else is served. Thai food is often accused to be quite strong and intensely flavored, and it can be for the unwary, the unsuspecting, and those who are rather unfamiliar with it. But it is transformed when it's mixed with this grain, this principal grain, this kernel of the cuisine. The dish that we're making today is something in Thai called khao kho kapi, which is a rice that's seasoned with shrimp paste. And I know that today's seminar was meant to be about a product. And I started off with the idea that we should be using rice as that base product, but I just couldn't help myself because Thai food is so elaborate, and whilst the rice is very good, it is the basis of the cuisine. It is rarely eaten alone. And so today we're just seasoning this with some shrimp paste. Rice, the Thai rice also has a fragrance and aroma that is outstanding. And strangely enough, we were down in Cappadocia earlier this week, and some of the rice that we had down there, hybridized rice, I think it was, if I remember correctly, was smelt very much the same and tasted quite similar to Thai rice, quite soft and aromatic. It was a really interesting rice that we had down there, and this is not too bad either. What Prin is going to do in a second is he's going to make a paste using a... Here. Using a... using some shrimp paste, which is the murky, delicious, smoky, dark soul of Thai cooking. It is made from dried prawns, it's made from fresh prawns that are fermented in the sun with some salt. It is perhaps almost disgusting, and it does smell like an old man, I confess. But nonetheless, it is quite delicious when seasoned properly, like indeed old men. This is made from in the south of Thailand. It is very soft and very malleable, and It's an acquired taste, I suspect, but once you acquire the taste, it's something that you just cannot put down. It's used in many, many dishes in Thailand. It is the basis of curries. But in this instance, it is the solid taste, it is the shrimp paste, which is very rich and prawny. And it is the basic, it's the basic taste that we'll be using to season the rice. But Thai food is, uses so many products. It's a wash with products, and sometimes it can almost be so confusing as you employ 7, 10, 15 different items to the, it's quite, can be quite confounding, quite difficult and quite confusing to a novice chef and indeed a novice diner, because it is ornate, it's Byzantine, it is elaborate, it has so many facets to it, because Thai food is about the taste of ingredients and the seasoning of those ingredients. What Prin is doing in his little pestle and mortar is he's going to make a paste from some garlic. Chai mai kap. He'll fry that off in some oil, and he'll fry that off until it gets golden, and he'll fry that off, hopefully he will fry that off very soon, because it needs to fry off quite quickly. He'll fry that off, and when that garlic starts to get golden, that's when we'll add some of this paste. Garlic and oil are so essential in this food as well, because you see, in order to strike a balance with Thai cooking, in order to deploy the products that are used in Thai cooking appropriately and skillfully and successfully, there's a balance that is needed, where you understand the techniques, you understand the taste, where you understand the product, you understand how it behaves when it is subject to certain culinary methods, to get the best from it. The Thais call that rot chart. And rot chart, I guess, can be translated as a clear and proper and correct taste, where every ingredient is tasted in its proper, determined, intended sequence. So for instance, what we'll be doing in a second is once that garlic fries off and is golden, maybe you can smell it, I can certainly start to smell it, make it cook.
Yes, Chef.
Yep. It's now beginning to colour. But it's not quite ready yet, because if I started to put my shrimp paste in now with that garlic not quite coloured, the garlic will have a raw, rather rank and disturbing aftertaste that will dominate the shrimp paste. What we want is this to turn golden. And as it turns golden, that raw taste becomes rather caramelized and nutty, and it lingers quite successfully on the palate and is a complement, a wonderful complement to the taste of this rather murky sole in my left hand, the sinister sole. Can you see here how it's starting to change color? Henry? It's also, I don't know whether you can smell it, but up here, up in our smelly stage, well, it is beginning to transform as it loses that sharp, almost peppery raw quality. And you can see perhaps now, Sai Ta Lai Ka. We're adding some shrimp paste. I don't think Prin will add enough. He never does. We need to fry that shrimp paste off, just that little bit. And then after that, we will add some, a little bit of water, so it helps to break down the shrimp paste as well. So then it is used to coat the rice. Just a little bit, do you think that's fragrant enough? Okay. It does smell like an old wrestler, I have to say, up here, ladies and gentlemen, with this shrimp paste. I suspect one of two of the chefs who have presented earlier on today and who'll present later on themselves will smell a little bit like an old wrestler too, because they were caught out going to Mikla last night. There's a laugh, a knowing laugh. We're adding just the right amount of rice, because you see, whilst this shrimp paste is the soul of Thai food and it is dark and dank and quite murky, it also has employed, or you're also using enough in order to get a nice silken aroma and taste, because Thai food is an exercise in balance. I know that perhaps is one of the most important things I can say today. It is an exercise in balance, where each ingredient, each product is employed in its proper proportion, in its proper sequence, in order to achieve a dish that is a composite array of tastes and textures, but becomes unified, harmoniously so, as you begin to cook and complete that dish. Whew, that was a sentence. Okay. What does it taste like, Chef? Tastes like last night. Yeah. Okay, now what he'll do now is he's going to put that to the side, aren't you, Chef? Say John, do you mind? Say John, you good day. Okay. This type of lunch, this type of rice is a very old-fashioned Thai dish, and it's normally eaten at lunch. I've got two Thais in the background and backstage, both of whom are hankering, longing to eat this type of stuff. It's a shame that you can't taste it, but at least I'll make the Thais happy as they begin to eat this. This is a lunchtime dish, and what he'll do next is this will cool down slightly. The rice is rarely eaten alone. It's seasoned rice, and this is the basis. It's at the moment quite salty and rich with the taste of guppy. It's almost like a dried sardine-like flavor, I suppose, if I wanted to try and make a comparison with some Turkish tastes. But Thai food can never leave well enough alone. This rice will now be seasoned with some fish. with some bonito, which of course is your local stuff. And what Prin has done earlier on is he's mixed some palm sugar with some fish sauce. And these are two other products that are so essential to the seasoning component, because Thai food is not only the ingredients that are used, but then there's a secondary component that is employed, and that's the seasoning component. So you begin to build up a depth of flavor, a dimension that makes Thai food without parallel, I think. Without parallel, because it has such a complexity yet elegance of taste and texture and subsequent seasoning. The seasoning, of course, will come from this fish sauce, which if the shrimp paste is the murky side of Thai food, the murky soul. This is its lifeblood. It's fish sauce, which tastes almost like anchovies mixed with water. It's murky, it's dank, it's slightly rank and fetid, let's face it. But when it's used as a seasoning, one of the delicious things about it is that intensity of flavor that can almost be objectionable is subsumed and becomes a wonderful, strong undercurrent of taste that supports the other seasoning components, which we'll start to play with. Now, in a moment, I'll start to season this because, yes, indeed, Chef. Do you want to turn this on? Make it work. Okay. What Prin will do is cook the fish in advance, and this fish is just cooked in some caramel, or not caramel really, it's the palm sugar that has been boiled down with a few red shallots, some lemongrass, and we'll add the bonito and just cook the buggery out of it. Is that on? It is not on. So this part of the dish, because this is the staple of the rice, which is has the shrimp paste, which is salty and rich, is then eaten with this caramelized fish. The bonito, which is your local bonito, which is just delicious, and I believe it's in season, it's at its best at the moment. And so I'm cooking this fish rather rapidly because the Thais believe that you should boil fish. I know that seems rather strange, and given the sophisticated techniques that have been employed earlier on today with the low temperature cooking and so on, this seems rather rough and rude and haphazard. But the Thais believe if you boil your fish, you never get the rank fishy taste in the dish itself. And I'm a bit of an old-fashioned chappy when it comes to cooking. I think that I'd rather follow that Thai method than employ more modern techniques. So, what we're looking at so far is a flavor combination of fish with shrimp paste, with sugar and with fish sauce, and that can just sit there rather nicely. Make it work, chef. That fish will cool down just a little bit. It's the basis of it is the fish sauce, but also palm sugar. Palm sugar is the most addictive thing. Often Thai food is accused or thought to be just sweetness. And that's just not quite true. That's when Thai food is cooked rather poorly, because Thai food, as I've mentioned several times on this stage rather nervously, it's a balance of textures and tastes and seasonings. But this palm sugar is fantastic, and it's another product that I thought I should talk about today, because it is the most delicious, unctuous, addictive, ambrosial product I know. It's made from literally the sap of a palm tree that's boiled down. There's no preservatives, there's nothing, no chemical in it. It's completely natural, and somehow I prefer that integrity of taste and integrity of product, where there is nothing but the product itself, just one ingredient. It's the sap is collected in the early morning. It's just literally boiled down until it caramelizes and crystallizes. And they do that by boiling the sap down and stirring it, just by hand, stirring it for half an hour to an hour, depending on how much they have. And as it begins to boil down, as that water begins to evaporate, it then starts to crystallize and caramelize, and you arrive at this fantastic condiment. Okay, ครับ. เดี๋ยวหน่อย. ใส่กุ้งใช่ไหมครับ? ก็เอามะนาวด้วยIf I guess there are four main tastes, seasoning tastes, five actually, in Thai food. It is the sweet, the salty, the sour, and this rice will be dressed with some little bit of lime juice and an Asian citron. That was something we smuggled in earlier today. One of the hidden crafts of my career and of my industry of traveling cooks is the art of smuggling. The That's how you get products in, ladies and gentlemen, to conferences such as this, is the crafty art of smuggling. And it makes me quite proud of my industry and my peers, because they can manage to secrete things in the most unlikely places in order to slip through customs or indeed slip through anywhere else. And so we've managed to get some limes from Thailand, some somsa, it's called in Thai, an Asian citron, which is not a local thing at all, and then also some chilies too, which are, we have two types here. This is called a Prik Tin Da, which is like just a long dragon's eye chili. It's got a rather romantic name, but it has, how may I say it, a little bit of a bite. And then the smaller chili, called Prik Anlek Nek Noi Kha. Which I delight in, is called a Prik Kin Usuan, which is a small little chili. It is delicious, it's aromatic, it's also bloody lethal as well, because it is hot. Damned hot, memorably hot, mind-snappingly hot at times. But the thing about Thai food is that whilst these are fun to play with and fun to eat, when you're cooking properly and responsibly, tastefully and rather safely, you employ these rather strong tastes and seasoning components. These condiments, you do it with a careful, considered application. Because the employment of the products so important to Thai food need to be put into the right sequence. And this is where method and taste comes in, and experience as well, in such an ancient cuisine, with such a long heritage of fine cooking. It's where each ingredient is employed to its proper extent in order to reach or to extract and to reveal, no, not reveal, that sounds so bloody pretentious, doesn't it? In order to arrive at the correct balanced taste, because you don't want to overwhelm the shrimp paste. You don't want to overwhelm the other ingredients that we're going to start to put in, do we, chef? Okay, are we there? Okay. This rice, can I do it from here? Is just about ready. It's cooled down a little bit. Shut up. All cooks always try to steal the limelight. Take it. Go. hang on. It's about me, not about him. Him and his bloody golden, bloody pestle and mortar. What a lovely little pestle and mortar that you've got there, chef. So very Thai. The rice is cooled just a little bit. It's relaxed. It's now warm. It's not too hot. You can taste the things, the shrimp paste quite properly. And now what we'll do is add some of the seasoning components, which are a little bit of grilled chili paste, which was made from some red shallots that have been charred. And we used a proper grill. That is, over charcoal. And we used it in a Turkish kitchen, I'm very happy to say. We were so relieved, our heart jumped, both Prinz and mine jumped with joy when we saw an open fire with some charcoal in the kitchen just here. And so we purloined it and grilled our shallots and grilled our chilies and grilled other components, because there is nothing like, when you have a good product, to then have some natural, almost overly old-fashioned flame. The thrill, no, the vitality of a dish is best seen when it's exposed to fire. And there's nothing more, I think, aromatic and vibrant and than using an open flame, or rather a grill with some charcoal. It ensures that the dish has some vitality about it, because there's an immediacy of taste that only can come from cooking properly, cooking naturally, and cooking simply. Some grilled shallots, are going through it, because this will start to then add a further flavor and taste. A little bit of grilled chili, because Thai food ain't nothing without chili. But it's only a small amount, because this dish isn't terribly hot. Now, you can put more chilies in if you wish, and if I were making it for myself, I might well do. But the best way to use chilies with a dish like this is you put them to the side, and you can season in your own way afterwards. Here, it's going to be subtle. It's going to be easy. It's going to be nice. It's going to be polite. I'm seasoning it now with some of that Asian citron. The illicit Asian citron. Thank you, chef. The other thing about using your products, no matter what it's called, The thing about this seasoning is that you can follow a recipe. I'm yet to meet a cook who actually can, by the way. You can follow a recipe, but the best way of cooking, if you're using great products and you're using old-fashioned cooking equipment such as the charcoal grill, is to use yet one other further instrument to determine the taste of an ingredient, and that ain't a recipe, it's your tongue. And so in order to get that balance, you need to keep on eating and tasting in order to achieve what I was rabbiting on about before. That rot chard, that balance of taste and textures. I'm adding some green mango to this. Not too much. That green mango is an unripe mango, naturally enough. And it will introduce a sourness. I'm adding a little bit of dried galangal, a little bit of chili powder, a few other things that I'm not going to tell you, otherwise I'll give away the recipe. A touch of vinegar. Oh. Some deep fried garlic, some lemongrass, because now what we've done, we've seasoned the rice. We've used the shrimp paste. I've got that base flavor I wanted, but now what I want to do is to add some fresh ingredients that then adds textural difference and a sprightly, zesty culmination to the dish. Some red shallots, some lemongrass, some chilies. Not too many chilies. I guess I'd probably add more chilies if you were coming up to taste it, because I have a childish pleasure in watching people sweat. A little bit more sourness. Some zest from this Asian citron. And then finally, some pomelo, which is kind of like a fleshy grapefruit, just thrown in at the last moment. So then you have a contrast of taste and texture. So you start off with the building block, the basis, that is the rice. You move to your shrimp paste, that murky sole. you have it with some sweet and salty fish, and you have the components that go into this rice. The vinegar, the lime juice, the galangal, the chili paste, these fresh ingredients as well, all of which add a layer upon layer, a taste and an aroma to bring the best out of this rice. Jim, my club. Yeah, it's not too bad. Ko chui no kap. Ko han ni noi. It's a simple dish. It's an easy dish. It's a dish that will please many, many Thais, particularly the two that are hanging around outside like hungry creatures. Ko sai noi kap. Same what? And so this easy dish, this simple dish, this dish that shows off Thai-ness and the products of Thailand is just about done. Khao Kho Kapi, which is rice seasoned with shrimp paste, has all the elements that makes Thai food, I think, so outstanding. It is great products, tried and true and ancient techniques that are based upon the most fundamental of all things, fire. With a heritage and recipes and a provenance of cooking that is truly, truly outstanding. For me, though I went to Thailand and was rather confused at the beginning with not only the culture and the people and the cuisine, it now begins to make sense to me because I no longer think about it. I taste it. It's a cuisine to be savoured because the products are so good. And the techniques employed to bring the best out of those products so honed over generations, it makes the food outstanding. At least to my mind, it's just a shame you can't have this. Some prawns, an egg, because what will happen is that you'll mix the egg through the rice because that will give you a nice richness. What pumps out in here? Do you have any tweezers? Do you have any tweezers?
I forget.
My pair of tweezers. Some fish. This caramelized fish. With some of the shallot as well. No tweezers. You're fucked. Okay, now what do I want now? I want my chilies. Where is it? Ko pak chi noi, huh? A little bit more of the garnish that I added before, that is the lemongrass and shallots. Maybe, just maybe a touch of deep fried garlic because I just can't help myself. A little bit of grilled chili, because you see, what will happen now is that when a Thai eats this type of food, it's not eaten as individual components. It's mixed together with a happy relish, a little bit of coriander, and I think some lime. And what the Thais would do is, do we have a spoon at all? Ko chon noi ha. Is they would mix all this together. Whilst there's a layering of components, and whilst the product itself has some rather separate integrity, By the time it gets to the plate, and by the time the tigers begin to wolf through their food, because they love their food so much, and with good reason, by the time they get to it, is that they will mix this all together. So these rather separate elements, like the caramelized fish, the egg, will be mixed through. And so you have this happy, well-seasoned, hopefully well-seasoned, delicious melange of flavors and textures that makes the basis of Thai food, where the product is employed, where several products are employed, working together to construct a taste, where it strikes a balance, a harmonious balance. And the complexity of Thai food is managing to strike that balance of flavors, where there's not a jumble of taste, there's not a jumble of taste, but there is in fact an elegant sequence of tastes that hits the palate in the intended way. And that's the genius of Thai food and the delight of Thai products. And that's it. I'm done. I can finish on that sentence. Thank you very much indeed. And the other thing that you need to do is to eat this with some vegetables, chef. So they would always have some vegetables with it. Some mint, some betel leaves, which again, ladies and gentlemen, were brought from Thailand using the chef's magical craft. That hidden craft, that surreptitious craft, that secretive craft, smuggling. So again, you tear this through and you'd eat with vegetables because they again add yet another flavor. Thai food, whilst it has, is complicated, and whilst it has elaborate and hopefully delicious technique employed, nonetheless considers the taste of the product, the taste of the ingredient as paramount, and everything is employed to achieve the best, to bring out that product, ladies and gentlemen, and that's it. Thank you. Prin, get rid of the shit and give me a pizza. Thank you.
Evet, şefimize çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Maalesef programımız biraz sarktı biliyorsunuz. Bu nedenle öğle yemeğine saat 2:15 gibi geçeceğiz. Şimdi arkadaşlarımız tekrar mutfağa topluyorlar. Son bir konuşmamız daha olacak yemek öncesinde yine bir sunumla birlikte. 2:15 gibi öğle yemeğine geçeceğiz. Öğle yemeğimizi 45 dakikada tamamlayıp arkasından 3'te tekrar oturumlarımıza devam edeceğiz. Değerli misafirlerimiz, şefimiz tekrar hazır. Sunumumuza başlıyoruz. Şefimiz OAD tarafından yılın en iyi restoran ödülüyle taçlandırılan Lumen'in şefi Luigi Taglianti.
Buongiorno, buongiorno a tutti. Grazie, grazie mille a tutti di essere qui. Ringrazio l'organizzazione di Gastromasa e tutto lo staff dietro che ci sta aiutando per gestire al meglio tutte le preparazioni. Mi sono permesso di offrirvi un po' di prodotto che è il limone, che è il mio ingrediente feticcio, è il mio marchio a fuoco, credo che stiano girando i limoni. E vi chiedo gentilmente se, mentre io inizio a cucinare, riuscite a stimolare gli oli essenziali di questo prodotto in modo da poter entrare in sinergia un pochettino con la mia cucina. E è un modo un po' diverso per portarvi un pochettino a casa mia, al ristorante. Il limone è un ingrediente per me fondamentale, secondo me è un ingrediente contemporaneo, perché è versatile, e utilizzato nel modo giusto è anche sostenibile, nel senso che si può utilizzare tutto e noi non buttiamo via nulla, quindi è una cosa che viene utilizzata tutta in cucina. Questo è per farvi un pochettino entrare, come dicevo prima, in sinergia con la cucina. Attraverso invece la ricetta, io voglio portarvi nella cultura italiana, che non è tradizione e ne è nemmeno ricette che uno può trovare nei libri storici di cucina tradizionale o classica, ma sono quei segreti nascosti e custoditi nella memoria di ognuno di noi, e fanno parte del nostro patrimonio familiare. Quindi è un pochettino la cucina di casa che io voglio trasferire oggi, perché in un mondo fatto di click che va troppo veloce, a volte manca lo studio, manca soffermarsi su quello che è già stato fatto e quasi dimenticato. Il piatto che io preparo oggi è una quaglia all'italiana, ovvero un ingrediente che si trovava una volta in quasi tutte le case di campagna e, come dire, è un ingrediente molto versatile, carni bianche, delicate, che in Italia oggi è quasi ormai in disuso. In Francia si utilizza molto, mentre in Italia abbiamo quasi perso questa tradizione di utilizzare questo volatile. La base... non sono andato a ricercare una tecnica, come dire, troppo forzata, ma ritorno all'utilizzo delle casseruole e all'utilizzo di quello che è quell'italianità che manca un pochettino oggi, quindi la vera cultura anche del cucinare, tornare indietro nel tempo e riappropriarci anche della nostra professionalità e della nostra professione. Quindi saper riconoscere un ingrediente, saperlo trattare, soprattutto attraverso anche il fuoco, che oramai sembra che nelle cucine quasi non esista più, no? Perché tutto va veloce e sotto vuoto. Quindi questa preparazione è una preparazione che, ripeto, si tramanda nella mia famiglia, dalla mia bisnonna alla mia nonna e anche mia mamma. Quindi poi, andando a studiare, soffermandosi, si vede che ogni famiglia ha la propria tradizione, che però si unisce a quello che è il patrimonio culturale italiano e fa sì che tutto questo possa essere custodito e a oggi trasferito anche nel mondo. Vediamo proprio, la mia idea è quella proprio di tornare al lavoro della casseruola tradizionale e al soffritto, cioè uno dei metodi che fanno parte della nostra cultura, quindi le verdure che cucinano lentamente nell'olio con uno spicchio d'aglio. Vediamo, vado ad aggiungere un battuto di capperi e una parte di pomodoro secco. Tutto così in casseruola cucinato lentamente. Allo stesso modo, sempre con uno spicchio d'aglio e un filo d'olio, vado ad arrostire questa quaglia, e poi che finisce in forno. Rileggendo le tradizioni, le ricette poi tradizionali, possiamo andare a scoprire che questi metodi riportano veramente a delle ricette identificative, quali il potacchio, che è quasi un intingolo, sparito come nome e come preparazione nella cucina tradizionale italiana, oppure la cacciatora, che sono quei sughi, quelle salse importanti della nostra cultura che a mio avviso non vanno perse. Nel frattempo con la piastra prende calore. Vediamo, le verdure devono appassire lentamente. E poi vado ad aggiungere il rosmarino. Molto rosmarino. In questo modo io con l'umidità delle verdure estraggo quella che è l'essenza importante di questa erba, che è profumatissima e che fa parte della nostra cucina. Io mi ricordo mio nonno era toscano, quando cucinava le quaglie le farciva con aglio, rosmarino, peperoncino e poi le finiva in forno, e mi ricordo questi profumi che adesso vorrei io in qualche modo trasferirvi. Cerchiamo di accelerare un filo la cottura della salsa per farla vedere. Diamo proprio le tecniche a volte vanno dissotterrate da quello che è il nostro patrimonio, senza andare a cercare veramente la ricerca assidua della tecnica. Tutto deve essere in funzione, a mio avviso, del sapore e di quei sapori italiani che ci contraddistinguono nel mondo. Le verdure sono appassite, sfumo con abbondante vino bianco, quindi ritorno a dare un'acidità importante alla preparazione. Okay. Metto le cuoglie, le coscette che ho disossato prima, pulite e disossate. Vado a concentrare il vino perché voglio estrarre massima acidità ed estrarre per riduzione anche tutti quelli che sono i sapori del rosmarino. Intanto in forno la quaglia, lavoriamo a 180 e gli diamo 2 minuti di forno, la lasciamo rosa al cuore. La nostra salsa sta riducendo. Io aggiungo una parte di polpa di olive taggiasche. Io sono ligure e quindi porto dietro tutti quelli che sono i sapori della mia terra. In questo modo il rosmarino tira fuori tutta la sua essenza e la rilascia all'interno del soffritto. Aggiungo una parte di salsa di pomodoro, già pronta, già cotta. E vado a cucinare per almeno... una volta si cucinava sulle stufe di legna a ghisa, per cui 3-4 ore di cottura, di modo che i profumi si intensificavano e si univano e si amalgamavano bene. Io per ragioni di tempo mi sono portato avanti e la salsa l'ho già pronta. Okay. Adesso Mario mi setaccia la salsa, la mettiamo dentro il passino e andiamo a setacciare il tutto anche con rosmarino, di modo che mentre spacchiamo le foglie vengano fuori ancora le profumazioni e gli oli della pianta. Io tiro giù, disosso la quaglia. Ok. Ok. Quindi separo i petti dalle cosce. Lasciando la cottura blu della quaglia, di modo che le carni rimangano delicate. Elimino per un attimo la pellicina croccante, che però non vado a buttare, la recupero. Utilizzo la salsa per glassare i petti della quaglia, quindi vado a creargli questa finta crosta cremosa. Sorry. Ok. Utilizzo ancora la casseruola dove ho scottato la quaglia. Ho salvato prima i fegati e i cuori della quaglia, quindi le interiora, non butto via nulla, li arrostisco leggermente. Aggiungo una parte di sale. E questa è la mia interpretazione di una quaglia all'italiana moderna. Quello che stiamo facendo a Milano è uno studio approfondito veramente di quello che si sta rischiando di perdere e riattualizzarlo senza stravolgerlo, ma riproporlo in una chiave del tutto personale, facendo attenzione veramente a quelli che sono gli antichi sapori, i sapori primordiali della vera cucina italiana, che rischiamo veramente di perdere perché siamo, come dire, influenzati troppo dal mondo esterno. Ok. Se abbiamo ancora un attimo, io avrei piacere di farvi assaggiare la salsa e di come in questo caso il limone che vi ho presentato prima entra in sinergia. Entra in sinergia con veramente la cucina di impronta più, dei sapori più tradizionali. Da questa salsa veramente percepirete che a volte anche lavorando in casseruola noi riusciamo ad estrarre tutti i sapori che noi andiamo a inserire all'interno della preparazione. In questo caso sentirete veramente una balsamicità, un'aromaticità data dal rosmarino importante. Questa è la salsa che assaggerete, una salsa veramente di famiglia, fatta in casa. Spero vi piaccia. Grazie.
Değerli misafirlerimiz, şimdi bir öğlen arası veriyoruz. Saat 3'te tekrar burada buluşuyoruz.